Huntress's Daughter. Chapter 2. First Blood. Wet, dripping and warm, the stench of iron was heavy in her mouth, dribbling in to quench the naked thirst of her parched throat in a cascade of individual beads of moisture. Then the burning sensation at the back of her throat, the choking, retching revulsion which sent her into a fit of spasms. Blood positively coated her sinuses, and for a moment amidst the panic, she struggled to deduce if it was hers, or from something else entirely. Perhaps it was hers. If so, she was drowning in her own blood. Ironic, wasn't it? Her tongue slid its way across the roof of her mouth, its path disrupted by the presence of a soft chunk of something, before the receptors on her tongue registered the heady taste of blood leaching out, leaking crimson down her gullet. She tried not to swallow the vile concoction of liquid, but the sensation was too close, and she swallowed despite herself. Nausea swam freely through her senses as a hacking cough tickled at the edge of her throat whilst she expelled the gruesome feast from her mouth. A lump of bloody sinew and muscle tissue in a pulpy scarlet mess. Or more, she tried to, as gentle but powerful fingers persuaded her otherwise, nudging the chunk of raw meat back into her mouth with a gentle push. She was too weak to resist, and it was with a ghastly slowness that it entered her mouth and down her throat. Raw blood, still warm to the touch, decorated the sides of her throat in a lacy pattern, vividly affecting every part of her body, which rejected the meat. However, she was powerless not to give in to the gentle urging. A carmine haze permeated her vision as the full force of her macabre dish came to bear. Nonetheless, she was almost regretful for feeling so revolted as her eyes slid open to a warm greeting. She looked up to see a pair of onyx-colored eyes seated behind that rabbit-like mask, akin to gemstones, scintillating with untold intelligence and compassion. It almost muted the viscous and greasy feel as the mass of flesh slid down her throat with ease, almost muffled her cries of pain as she tried to regurgitate her meal, but to no avail, as the predator before her held her down, preventing her from being sick and completing any action apart from thoroughly digesting her meal. The taste of blood in a fibrous filament cobweb of veins, salty and all too tender, yet also pulsating with the fading vestiges of life, was a conflicting feeling. Anna tried not to think too long and hard about the creature from which it had came. A reflection stared back at her, filled with a maternal love which she couldn't help but nestle into. Between the two discordant ideals, Anna wasn't sure what to feel. Was this penance for her depravity? Understanding lit up Anna's eyes. No, it wasn't at all. This was her way of nursing her young, her child. Her heart skipped a beat, peculiarly lightweight, unaffected by the gravity of the situation. Stop it, she's trying to kill you. But try as she did, she couldn't help from letting the soothing emotion into her heart. She thought that by feeding her raw flesh, tissue and all, she was doing the right thing. The logical side of her mind writhed back into action. No, she couldn't. Nobody cared about her. She would give her the slightest taste of safety, dangling the tantalizing prospect just within her reach before pitilessly ripping it away. And back to the beatings, the hurt, the pain, the blood. And as Anna considered the malicious, dull gleam, as the bloodied hunting hatchet caught the moonlight, she supposed that the cutting instrument would take part as well. A slowly sickening feeling enveloped her, as with each moment the taint of the rare meat crept deeper into her stomach. With each passing moment, it became a lesser prospect that she would be able to regurgitate the intoxicating flesh from her system. She squirmed under the huntress's grasp, attempting to break free so she could allow herself but a single moment in which she could accomplish her purpose. The huntress didn't allow her any, holding her down until she was satisfied that she had swallowed it sufficiently. As soon as she let up with her hold, Anna doubled over in pain, seizing, fruitlessly trying to rid the toxin from her system. It wasn't that she had never eaten meat before. She had, when her mother had remembered to feed her. Brief lapses of lavish feasts, tables replete with delectable treats, she would devour in a hurried fashion, afraid that her mother would change her mind. And to think they were only leftovers from her mother's ceremonies. Occasions of raucous, shrill laughter, which she never knew the reason of. And music. Oh, the music. She strained to hear it. Pressed her ears tight against the oak door, against the brass handle, locked as always. The faint sounds of a violin, the stray note of a piano. However, this was different. Lances of torment perforated through her stomach to the point where she felt as if the white-hot spear was embedded in her intestinal tract. And then there was the cool caressing of a palm, an exercise in contrast with the fiery agony. Anna whimpered and leaned into the hand. Again, there was the hesitance. Anna could feel it from the trembling in the hand which comforted her. However, that very same grasp became firm, clamping down once more, and strongly, until it started to hurt. The breath, hot and humid on her face, took on an unnatural rhythm, each breath more severe than the last. Lights started pounding on the periphery of her vision as she cried out in pain. The pain abruptly stopped. Then there was a heated warmth as she felt a substance nuzzle into her neck. It was the nose of the hair mask. Close up, she realized, was a completely different perspective as she began to perceive the fine distinctions in her appearance. From the chipped ear of the hand-painted mask to the exquisite black tourmaline of her pupils. It was all abruptly more lush, more real. Her eyes turned to the fine mist of blood which covered the mask's every available surface. A scorching vermilion. So pretty. So beautiful. No, not beautiful. There was nothing beautiful about the suffering, the pain the monster had brought. Still, the metallic scent stirred something inside of her, roused the pounding throb of her heartbeat. She imagined the wound from which the blood had come, a bloody gash, hemorrhaging blood, sweet as treacle. It sent an exhilarating pulse arcing through her mind, an injured elk ripe for the hunt. No, that was wrong. What was she thinking? It was revolting that she would even think that. She was always so wrong, abhorrent, unloved. Maybe that's why no one wanted her. The huntress's arms slid over her waist, comforting her, urging her to fall into her embrace. She was still for a second, momentarily forgetting who she was hugging, craving nothing but the human contact. Horrified, Anna futilely tried to escape from her embrace, only to bring herself deeper into her warmth. It was so unfair. How could a murderer who had slaughtered her family be so warm? Anna studied the masked figure before her, savoring the contrast of the coarse threads of the blood-stained sarafan against the velvety smoothness of her fingers. The moment was soon broken by the sound of gnashing mandibles, filled with a ravenous, hollow hunger, followed by an unearthly cry, resounding through the still air. It spoke of an incessant hunger that would never be satisfied, devouring all. She imagined the behemoth from which the cry had come, imagining it salivating at the thought of flesh and blood, imagined it turning its grisly gaze towards her. Anna nestled deeper into the huntress before her, irrational fear overtaking her mind. It would come for her. It would kill her. A reassuring hand caressed her shoulder, and she realized she had begun shivering. The full moon was high in the sky, tinting the roughly hewn timber supports with teal. It was some time after midnight, and scampering and scuttling footsteps rang outside, a fact that made her afraid. The murderess extricated herself reluctantly from Anna's grasp. A glacial, howling breeze meandered through the door, bringing forth the scent of the festering underground and gangrene, the smell of corruption, making her abruptly wish that the predator, the hunter, no, the huntress before her would stay. Whatever was out there seemed to be suddenly far worse. "Wait, don't go, please," Anna whispered, barely believing her own audacity. The huntress eyed her with another longing gaze. This time, it was full of warmth as she rose, taking the hefty broadaxe with her. "I'll be back, Kiska. Wait there," were her unspoken words. Anna was as tightly strung as, well, she wasn't quite sure, as the rigid blade of a knife? No, that wasn't quite it. She felt so tightly strung as if she could be plucked and vibrate in a violent detonation of anxiety bundled up inside of her. A broiling storm had started brewing outside, a fine misting haze of rain and ominous clouds enshrouding the moonlight. The crackle of thunder sent adrenaline coursing through her limbs, and an onslaught of wind tore voraciously at Anna, clawing at her skin with wicked talons. A flicker of light stretched across the wooden planks, and if she really focused, she could see the path of wooden grain pirouetting in an intricate path through the mottled wood. She was quite familiar with the intricate figures the light wove, how it painted in a new luminance onto her crimson blood, staining her otherwise pristine white skin. But now, only trepidation ran through her veins like lead. She had tried all measures of straining, tearing, and wriggling. Yet the rough and chafing rope refused to budge in the slightest. Not that it was surprising, given that it was as thick as a python with abrasive scales to match. She crumpled inwards, clutching at her throat with scarcely hopeful fingers, attempting to regurgitate her so-called meal to no success. She wasn't sure what to call her, but huntress seemed to fit the most. From the carnivorous way, she eyed Anna, watching her like a lynx upon her quarry, but also the starkly contrasting warmth she exhibited. The huntress had done such a good job ensuring that she had fully digested her meal, refusing to let her go until it was irrevocably swallowed. And now she had fits of pain plagued her as her body rejected flesh. The downpour intensified, torrential swaths of rain inundating the outside forest, concealing the horror which lay within. Anna sat amongst a pile of pillaged wooden toys, dolls, and faded storybooks, illuminated by the dim flame of two tallow candles nearby. The discolored wallpaper around her held stains of congealed blood and scratch marks sinking into the splintered wood. How many had been here before her? What had happened to them? How would she escape? It was strange. She had thought it was mere hours ago that she wished for her death, but now, more than ever, she sought escape. A peculiar thought indeed. The putrefying scent of the rain upon the decaying forest floor was akin to the fetid breath from the maw of a beast heavy upon her throat. Her back was ramrod straight, held up only by the force of the tension rippling through her muscles. She had to go, she had to... Anna took a few calming breaths whilst the rational side of her brain took hold. Panicking here wouldn't help her in the least, so she turned her eyes towards her surroundings. An upturned toy, a wooden horse, sat beside her, and without pause, her hands shot out to grab it. She cradled it against her chest. It was a weapon, a pitiful one at that, but it would do. Nonetheless, she needed to get away, her hands grasping stubbornly at the unbudging knot in a fruitless affair, the rough hemp digging into her hands. A screeching eruption of sound and a blood-curdling scream, ripe with torment, rippled through the air, and her hands became numb, held captive by terror. She froze, paralyzed by the dread surging through her veins, her throat constricted, pupils dilating, taking in unadulterated fear. The cloying, metallic scent engulfed her senses, bringing her back. She was wrong. It was her fault. All of it. She was wrong. She couldn't be forgiven. Shattered fragments of china tinkling against the marble tiles, crimson over the white tiles. It all seemed to come rushing back to her, all at once. Her mother was shouting at her now. Her mother, her mouth distending wide beyond what any human should have been capable of. But it didn't seem to register to Anna, seeming to come from far away, off in the distance. Her fingers had been oh so sweaty. She'd been desperate to please Mother this time. So desperate. So desperate that when the wafer-thin plates had slipped from her grasp, her hands had futilely reached out, the shards cutting sharply into her fingers, drawing blood. She hadn't meant to. She hadn't. The bleeding wouldn't stop, but she wasn't afraid of the blood staining her pale, twig-like hands. No, she was more afraid by the vacancy in her mother's eyes. Her mother's eyes bored into hers, hollow husks devoid of empathy, filled with nothing but hell-bent anger. And then came the pain, the stinging sensation of her mother's hand upon her cheek, drawing tears from her eyes. She hit her again and again, until rivulets of blood streamed freely from her mouth and her skin. It wouldn't stop. It wouldn't stop. She didn't want her mother to keep hitting her anymore. It hurt too much. She didn't want to think anymore. Perhaps it didn't matter if she died. She was screaming again, the screeching sound resonating through her very being. Her mother didn't like screaming, but she couldn't seem to stop herself. It would be over more quickly if she didn't scream, but she couldn't stop herself no matter how hard she tried. A strangled whimper exited her throat as her fingernails found purchase, drawing blood, trying desperately not to collapse. She sat in crippling silence, listening to the screams from the outside, unfeeling frigid hands choking her, stifling her panicked breaths. Her thoughts trickled back to the warmth that the Huntress had shown her. No, it was all a lie. She would die like all the rest. Resisting would only prolong her life by a few seconds. She was crying now, choking back tears, not noticing the passage of time. A peal of lightning and a silhouette emerged in amidst the downpour. A figure approached her, clad with a sarafan, saturated with fresh blood. She was coming for her, to finally claim her life, to give her what she deserved. She was breaking into little pieces, so many that she could no longer stand on her own. "Stop, please, stop," Anna pleaded, holding out the miniature wooden horse in front of her in a pathetic attempt to ward off her killer. She was going to die. She could hear the whispers of the dead come to claim her. However, the spectral figure kept moving towards her. She couldn't. No, she couldn't. The wooden horse slipped uselessly from her fingers and collided with the wooden floor as the Huntress cradled her in a warm embrace, pulling her into her sodden clothes. She sang gently to her, whilst Anna cried into the redness of her dress, protected from the storm outside, gradually ushering in unconsciousness.